Today we're talking about Afghanistan, said no politician in the last 10 years. Yeah, Afghanistan, a war that might experience a surge of popularity soon because it's on the verge of becoming retro. To get a little more specific, I want to talk about Erik Prince, the CEO of Blackwater, a private military contractor that lives up to its name regarding transparency and general lack of murkiness. Seriously, who names a private military company Blackwater and thinks, well, clearly we're the good guys? Black is the worst color of water. I'd even prefer yellow. I mean, you already have the last name Prince working against you, although still less maligned than your sister's name, Betsy DeVos. Maybe just go with Democracies R Us. Anyways, Erik has an interesting idea for Afghanistan.
Right now there's 15,000 US troops and another 30,000 contractors. All I need, my plan would say 2,000 US special forces remain and about 6,000 contractors. So by any stretch, that is a severe reduction in manpower and certainly in spending.
After 14 years of American forces in Afghanistan, Erik Prince is pushing to completely privatize this war. Which is unfortunate because our commander-in-chief currently knows more than the generals about Afghanistan. What I want to do in this episode is see what a fully privatized war would look like, and talk through whether this is a good idea or not for America's oldest war, or that most people would probably be more than happy to just dump into an old folks' assisted living facility. Alright, so what would it look like to have a corporation fighting in Afghanistan? Well, according to Erik Prince, my proposal is for a sustainable footprint of 2,000 American special operations and support personnel, as well as a contractor force of less than 6,000. Alright, so what specific problem are we trying to solve? Well, while Americans don't think about the war in Afghanistan often, our budget certainly does.
The amount of money that we're spending as a country there, $62 billion this year, is more than the entire UK defense budget. It's more than the entire US Department of Homeland Security budget. We're wasting a lot of money. A smaller, more unconventional approach is necessary.
Currently, this is a $62 billion a year war that nobody cares about. Kind of like the most expensive gym membership ever. We just keep letting it roll over. You know, I really should cancel it, but I don't want to look like I've given up. Generally, the war has been presented as a you're in or you're out approach, but the way Prince sees it, his proposal provides a third path that would put in place a light footprint of American special forces as well as contractors to work with Afghans to focus on the goal that America really cares about, denying America's enemies the sanctuary they used to plan the September 11th attacks. Oh yeah, and we're gonna have to make sure they're private contractors rather than government employees because, well, he put a lot of effort into that proposal and needs a cut. The proposal didn't really go into detail over why we need private contractors instead of American special forces, but it did mention that this would eliminate the stigma of a foreign occupying force. I can't imagine nothing more demeaning than a foreign occupier. Except a foreign corporate occupier. Hey, America isn't occupying us anymore, now it's a company. I can taste our renewed sovereignty already. I'm really hungry, I hope a McDonald's invades soon. There's one other advantage I found in an interview.
We're not winning there. So, to restructure that, as I laid out in the Wall Street Journal article, you have to put someone clearly in charge. The interagency process, you've had 17 different commanders in 15 years. That's not even counting ambassadors or CIA station chiefs. So you have to have one person that is clearly in charge of all U.S. policy, spending, rules of engagement of the effort there.
Wow, now that is kind of sad. We need consistency in our Afghanistan strategy, and corporations are more consistent than the government. Which, I hate to say, kind of makes sense. I mean, we're on our 17th commander in a 17-year war, and it's never a good sign for war when your commanders have the job turnover rate of a suicide bomber. This consistency also would apply to lower level soldiers.
Putting mentors in at the battalion level allows them to attach and to know that area, to know that valley, to know the local government officials in that area. That gives you multi-year continuity because when a US guy goes in, like I said, he goes in for 9 months And he leaves, and that local knowledge leaves with him.
So he envisions private ex-military leadership being attracted through his company to stay in Afghanistan for longer periods of time than would normally be in order to keep and maintain relationships with local leadership and provide long-term mentorship for the local Afghan soldiers. So all of that sounds pretty good. What's the problem? Well, there's some philosophical problems. For example, a profit motive runs contrary to the national strategic goals of the mission in Afghanistan. Why would the company that wins this billion-dollar contract ever want the war to end? I mean, that would be like trying to get big pharma and insurers to design our healthcare system, while oil men run our energy departments and... Wow, that started out as a joke. This is why we recently saw General Mattis say, when the Americans put their nation's credibility on the line, privatizing it is probably not a wise idea. That's not the only issue, because some people are saying, when it comes to occupying force, size matters.
Let me share with you some criticism of your plan.
Sure.
Sean McVeigh in Politico magazine, I'm sure you've seen this, is a piece called, "I Was a Mercenary, Trust Me, Erik Prince's Plan is Garbage." Tough words. Prince is an amateur and makes rookie mistakes, which is probably why the generals laughed at him. Somehow he believes 6,000 mercenaries and a small air force can solve Afghanistan's problems. This is magical thinking. NATO could not succeed with 140,000 troops 8 years ago when the Taliban was in retreat.
Wow, it takes courage to read that out loud to an ex-Navy SEAL. I read the article and it basically says that everything Prince is suggesting we do, the US is already doing. And he emphasizes that Prince's plan will probably just do everything the US is already doing, but worse. The problem is, when you run things like a company instead of a nation, well, the things you can do are just different. For example, according to Prince, all will be brave Americans who are former special operations veterans. More sales talk. To keep costs down, you will probably have to outsource to the so-called third world, where military labor is cheap. Take for example Triple Canopy. See, there's a non-evil private military contractor name.
So Obama picked this firm Triple Canopy.
They were the official go-to firm for the Obama private military contracts. Triple Canopy initially only hired the best of the best and paid very well for the talent. But as the war in Iraq ground on and the company expanded rapidly, things got lax. Yeah, things got super lax. And despite the marketing that they were getting soldiers from the top shelf, they were getting them from the top shelf of an entirely different cabinet.
Triple Canopy was also known for being the company that brought in the largest number of so-called third country nationals, non-Iraqis, non-Americans. They hired, for instance, former Salvadoran commandos who were veterans of the bloody counterinsurgency war in El Salvador that took the lives of 75,000 Salvadorans minimum. Chileans, they used the same recruiter, Jose Miguel Pizarro Ovalle, that Blackwater used when they hired Chileans. This was a former Pinochet military officer.
So most people are speculating that it's going to be hard to get thousands of high-ranking American soldiers to want to stay in Afghanistan training their militaries for years on end at a good price. So we might end up importing a fair amount of cheap soldiers from the Philippines, Uganda, and Colombia, three countries with the type of human rights records that would make me want to have them training soldiers and rebuilding a nation. I want to remind viewers that this is theoretical, but I think it might come to fruition because of this recent, totally unrelated report on Erik Prince.
Turning now to Erik Prince, the former founding head of the military contracting firm Blackwater. Several of the group's contractors were convicted of killing 17 Iraqi civilians in 2007. Prince, the brother of Education Secretary Betsy DeVos, has since sold the company. During the election, he also supported and financially backed then-candidate Trump. Now he reportedly has a new goal in mind, setting up Blackwater-style training camps in China.
Well, I'm sure that's not going to roll over in any way. So at this point, I'm sure some of you were wondering, is this happening? Well, it's really up in the air right now, as there's a rift in the White House because different people have different opinions. And because of this consistently revolving door of leaders, you get a lot of opinions. Early in the administration, the National Security Advisor, Lieutenant General H.R. McMaster, was the strongest critic, and Secretary of State Rex Tillerson and Defense Secretary General James Mattis were also not in favor. Now, two-thirds of those people are out, and their replacements are more amenable to the idea. Jared Kushner, the man tasked with procuring peace in the Middle East, is an advocate for this idea. And the current Secretary of State Mike Pompeo and National Security Advisor John Bolton will be much more receptive, Mr. Prince believes, to his plan. Don't worry, he also definitely has the president's ear.
The Washington Post is reporting on an alleged back channel between the White House and the Kremlin. It involves a major donor to President Trump named Erik Prince, who reportedly met with an ally of Russian President Vladimir Putin in January in Seychelles.
Okay, well that inspires a ton of confidence in this guy. The most recent update on our strategy in Afghanistan came on August 21st when President Trump announced he is pursuing a dramatically different strategy in Afghanistan that will bear better results. What is this new strategy? Trump has signed off on the deployment of at least 3,500 fresh advisors, trainers, and other support troops that the US commander in Kabul asked for. Ah, so more conventional troops. A very dramatic change indeed. That is the exact opposite of what Erik Prince wants. Still though, as of now, Prince is meeting with White House officials to try to get his alternative plans for Afghanistan off the ground. Thank you, and that's all I have to say about that. Hey YouTube, I hope you enjoyed this episode. If you want to support independent, nonpartisan journalism covering the White House and things we're doing right now, be sure to subscribe to my channel. Remember to give us a thumbs up and ring that bell to let liberty continue to ring in America. So, every time, thank you for watching.